Okay. Do you hear me? Oh, it's on. All right. So, hi, guys. So, all right. So, I will only talk about bounded degree graphs in this talk. Let's introduce some notation. Let's call it GD. That's, you know, set of connected graphs with degree bound D. And this will be our universe. This is what we want to understand. And I'm a group theorist. My upbringing is actually finite group theory. And before I go into the whole lecture, I just want to tell you like a problem, which will look like a pseudo problem, but it can be made into a precise problem. And that has not much to do with what I say in the middle of the talk. Maybe at the end I will tell. But this is the thing that got me into graph limits. So let me say it. So this is the problem of two fat sisters. So here are the two fat sisters. That's kind of an abstract thing. All right, and whatever one of the sisters does, the other tries to do it as well. So they look the same locally, okay? They try to mimic each other, so if you sample one or sample the other, they look alike. All right, now one of the sisters, well, they are fat, right? So one of the sisters decides to go on a diet. A diet is not a local thing. Everyone who ever took diet knows it's not a local thing, that's a global thing. So that means that he just takes himself, well, she's a graph after all, and she rewires herself using a bi-Lipschitz map. That's taking a diet, okay? So she keeps the body, I mean, she keeps the vertices. She puts, you know, she puts new edges on herself. And this is, and the new graph and the old graph are bi-Lipschitz with some fixed bi-Lipschitz constant, all right? The question is, the big question in the mind of the other sister is, of course, what is the question? Whether the other sister can mimic this sister. So, you know, they only look the same locally, they may not look the same globally, okay? But is it enough, if they locally look the same, is it enough to, that this woman will go on a diet, at the end of the diet, it will be kind of the same or similar by Lipschitz constant, and the number of edges here and the number of edges here, that will be the weight, are roughly the same, okay? So this is actually a problem about hyperbolic free manifolds in disguise, and this is what got me into this whole subject. So I'm not going to elaborate on that now. Maybe at the end of the talk I'll get back to it. Okay, so it's still open. All right. So let's first, I don't think there was ever there was some kind of definition of Benjamin-Isham convergence, but certainly not my type of definition. So let me define it. So before we go into that, there is a very natural kind of convergence on graphs if they are rooted graphs. So for if you have rooted bounded degree graphs, so GD with a root, that's a very natural topological space, right? You say that, you know, two guys are close if they coincide on a huge ball around the root. And this gives rise to a convergence, and this space is compact. Okay, so that's a nice space. And, you know, if you study graph convergence, you could just study this and be done with it. But this convergence, I mean, if you take a sequence of graphs, just put roots in it and take a subsequence that converges, it's a compact space. Well, that's not very helpful. Why is it not very helpful? Most of the interesting stuff just escapes to infinity when you push the button, pushing the button, passing to the limit, right? So if you're a probabilist, then what you do is that, you know, you still do rooted limit, but you keep all the information. Every individual imagines that he's the root. When you push the button, you remember the collective individual memories, the collective local memory of the graph. Does this make sense? And that's what you get. That's Benjamin-Isham convergence. So let's do it a little bit more formal. So if you have a graph, if that's an unrooted graph, then I introduce a measure. I call it mu g. So mu g, that's a random rooted graph. Okay, and you get the random rooted graph from this finite graph by, you know, uniformly randomly assigning the root. So you can turn one nice graph into a probability measure on GD, on this compact space. Okay, and then Benjamin Isram convergence is simply weak convergence in this universe.
You mean not GD, on GD root.
Yes, that's right, on GD root. So let me lift the two fat sisters, which is not so easy, right? So, yeah. So that's the definition. That's one of the definitions of Benjamin Isram convergence. So Gn is Bs convergent if mu Gn weakly converges. And also, although this is a more abstract definition than the sampling definition, which is trivially equivalent to it, this allows you to tell what the limit is immediately. The Benjamin Isram limit of a graph sequence is the limit of those measures. So it's a random rooted graph. So limit of Gn is defined as, you know, as a random graph with low, the limit, the weak limit, weak star limit of mu Gn. Okay, so that's what I mean. So every guy, every vertex with the same probability in the graph imagines that he's the center of the universe, collects all the memories around, you know, remembers the neighbors' neighbors, less and less, because that's what weak topology means, right? And then you collect all these memories and you take the limit of this collection. And of course, that's all the local information you can get out of the system. And of course, the collected memories of a community is still less than the community itself. And this is what happens. It doesn't remember some of the global information. And the thing that where you show this usually, this is the random deregular graph. Versus the random bipartite. Irregular graph, you know, these look the same locally, it's just a tree. You see a tree from most points. And globally, of course, they differ a lot. So they are very different graphs. Okay, so let's talk about graph parameters. So you have a function from GD to R, or basically anywhere, any topological space does it, is testable. If FGN converges whenever GN converges. Okay? So that's a natural property of graphs. You want to know what are the parameters that are continuous in this topology. And you can come up with trivial parameters that are continuous. The first non-trivial parameter I would mention is that, so that M of G, which is the size of the maximum matching, divided, normalized, this is testable. Okay, this is a theorem of many, many, many groups did this. Alec Lipner and Boy. I don't remember. Guyen Onak and maybe a third group as well. So yeah, so this is what's happening here is kind of this building connection between graph theory and group theory through graph limits. This was a lot of it was influenced at least by Gábor Elek. So if I don't put enough Gábor Eleks in the talk, just put it there in your mind. So okay, so. All right, so this is testable. Now tell me a non-testable one. It's basically on the board. That's the independence ratio, right? That's not testable, and it's here. So I of G is not testable. Okay, so it's somewhat surprisingly, the following thing is testable. If you take the adjacency matrix of G and take the rank of it, rank of the adjacency matrix, normalize it by G, is testable. Which is surprising a bit, because this is, you can say it in graph theoretic language, this is to find a maximal independent subset of vertices in the set that you call a subset independent if the rows, the corresponding rows in the adjacency matrix are independent, linearly independent. That doesn't look like a local property. It looks much less local than graph theoretic independence, which is not local, right? Which is not testable. Nevertheless, this is true, and I will even prove this. And this gets us closer to the nicest thing that is testable, you know, which is basically under most of the testability results, and this is that the spectral measure or the eigenvalue distribution is testable. So let lambda g be the eigenvalue distribution of the adjacency operator of G. Okay, so just take the eigenvalues and normalize, you know, with multiplicity, normalize it to be a probability measure. And this is a nice little lemma that this is testable. So lambda G is testable in the meaning that if you have a convergent graph sequence and the eigenvalue distribution weakly converges. And actually, what does it converge to? And I'm not going to go into that. So what is the limit of this of a Benjamin-Disham convergent sequence of graphs? That's a random rooted graph, right? Well, an infinite graph doesn't have a spectral measure. It's not well defined. But once I put a root on it, the rooted infinite graph does have a spectral measure. Okay? And now you can take the expected spectral measure with respect to the randomness. And this is the spectral measure of the limit of a random rooted graph. And this is where it will converge to. So converges to the expected spectral measure. Okay. So this, if I tell a proof at all, then I will tell this proof. It's a smart proof. It's not a long proof, but it's a smart proof. It's worth to learn it. So why is this true? This is a simple statement. Why is this true? Well, what is weak convergence? Weak convergence means that you know, against any continuous functions, so against any polynomials, against any power, it's convergent. And well, what is this? This is, you know, if you integrate x to the k against d lambda g, right? That's nothing else but the sum of the kth powers of the eigenvalues normalized. Well, that's nothing else than the trace of the adjacency matrix to the k, again, normalized. But this is nothing else than the expected number of returning paths of length k. Right? And this is obviously testable. If I give you the distribution of k balls in a graph, then you can say exactly what this is, what this expected number is. So this is testable for all k. So you get weak convergence of the eigenvalue distributions. Oh, by the way, you're encouraged to shout into my talk. That's when I feel good. You're silent, then I start to fall asleep. And everyone starts to fall asleep.
Can you explain that thing that's in parentheses that you said about the infinite random graph and the spectral measure and what it converges to?
Okay, so just an infinite say, the regular graph doesn't have a spectral measure. It has a spectrum, but not a spectral measure. But so let's go pragmatic. If it's rooted, then you can just take the probability of returns of the random walk and make it into the moment of a measure. It turns out that there is a measure for which these are the moments. That's the spectral measure of the. Yeah, you can do it from high above. You know, it's a projection. It's a dimension of a projection. But you know, that's what it is. No, the statement is that if you have a Benjamin-Schramm convergent sequence of graphs, then the eigenvalue distributions converge to the expected spectral measure of the limit graph. The limit graph is a random rooted graph, so it has an expected spectral measure, and this is where it converges to. That's a very interesting object, actually, to take this unimodular. Of course, if it's one vertex sensitive graph, then it's really the spectral measure of the graph. But often it's not, and it's very interesting to look at this object. Like, you have the expected spectral measure is usually something much smoother than the individual measure. It's very interesting to see how it decomposes. And, you know, I don't know how much is known about that. So, all right. Okay. So basically that means that if I know the Benjamin-Schramm type of a graph, then I can guess the shape of the eigenvalue distribution. And this is where the first part, real part of the story starts. So here is a philosophy for you. Limit theories are cool. Even if you don't have a limit object, you just say what's the definition of convergence. That's kind of cool because it puts some kind of rule over your universe. You know, usually it's not so easy to rule over the universe of graphs, right? They are unruly. And just if you say what is convergent, that puts an order on it. You tell when two graphs are close, you know, they are related even in some topological sense. That's cool. So already it's meaningful to formulate results in terms of that. But what is even more beautiful is when you actually have a limit object. Usually you have some abstract limit object. An ultra product usually does the job. But if the limit object has an extra beauty, an extra force, then you can play the following game. You want to prove an asymptotic statement on all finite graphs of bounded degree. So you assume by contradiction that it's not true. You take a sequence of counterexamples. Benjamin-Schramm convergence is compact. I mean, sequence, you can choose a convergent subsequence. This has a limit. Now, hopefully, some of your, you know, the stuff that you're looking at passes on to the limit. But the limit object is stronger than a finite graph in some sense. And I tell you in what sense. So there you get a contradiction, and then you can pull it back. Okay, so that's the machinery. So this is the beautiful thing when, you know, energy flows up to infinity and something comes back. And I will tell you an example for that. And then often you can do like more precise. This always gives you a soft result, right? Because of the weak convergence. It doesn't allow you to give you like hard, you know, hardcore estimates. But you know, often you can go and work and get more precise estimates on individual finite graphs. So that's a story I want to tell first, and this is about Ramanujan graphs. So the basic question is, what can this guy look like? What can the eigenvalue distribution look like? Let's pass to D-regular graphs, just to avoid having to distinguish, you know, like Laplacian and Markov and whatever. So we are D-regular. Graphs, what can lambda g look like? What can be the shape? What do we know about that? So just imagine that this is like a jelly, right? It's 1 pound of jelly. That's the eigenvalue distribution. And you want to know where you can massage it. So that is the eigenvalue distribution of a D-regular finite graph. And the first theorem here is, well, it's the Alon-Bhopala theorem. But before I say that, I just say what. So let rho g be the spectral radius of g. Okay. So for an infinite graph, this is just the norm of the adjacency operator. For a finite graph, it's also the norm of the adjacency operator, but you want to cut off the trivial parts. You want to cut off the eigenvalue d, and also the eigenvalue minus d for this dog. So that's a norm with some modifications if g is finite. What's nice about it that it also measures the exponent of probability return, the return probability of a random walk. So this is also the limit of the 2nth root of p2n. Okay, where p2n, well, So you pick a root, it's a connected graph, you do a random walk for 2n steps, you look at the probability of return, take the 2nth root and take the limit. The first nice, easy exercise is to show that this is independent of the limit. And then it goes on until you prove this equality. Okay? So that's that. Often this is what you use and that's what you think about. Sometimes the other way around. So that's the spectral radius. And then there is what is easy to see. So lemma, g is infinite. Then the spectral radius of g is at least the spectral radius of the deregular tree. Why is that? Well, the deregular tree covers g. It's the universal cover of g. And that, you know, taking this cover decreases the probability of return, so it cannot increase the limit, right? And that's about it. Now, because we modified the notion of spectral radius for finite graphs, this proof doesn't work. And there is the Allon-Boppana theorem, which is an easy theorem, a basic theorem. And it tells you that for any gn, the lim inf of gn is greater than or equal than rho td if the size of gn tends to infinity. Okay. Huh? Yeah. So this tells you that the jelly, you know, this jelly can beat the Allon-Boppana bound, but not by much. And as the graph tends to infinity, it has to at least set the boundary. We call a graph Ramanujan if it satisfies this inequality. So g is if rho of g is less than or equal than rho of td. And, you know, everyone knows here that you know the story, right? It's not so easy to construct Ramanujan graphs, and Lubotsky, Philipp, Sarnak gave the first construction. It was a rather non-trivial construction. And since then, they didn't find so many other constructions. So LPS construction, this only works for certain degrees. Yeah, you know the story. I don't want to go into it. What's interesting here for us, that this LPS construction is basically a free group. You have a lattice, which is a free group, and you take normal subgroups in this free group. So these guys will have large girls. The reason why it has large girth is not spectral. A priori, it's group theoretical. It has large girth because it comes from a free group. There are Cayley graphs coming from the free group. And then there are graphs that are not Ramanujan, but we know that they are almost Ramanujan. These are random graphs, random deregular graphs. This is a theorem of Joel Friedman. And they also have large girth in the meaning that from most points, they have large girth. So they converge to the deregular tree. Friedman is that random graphs are almost Ramanujan. Okay, and they converge to the tree. We know that. Can't hit that. Okay. So, you know, the question is what's up? And what's up here is now we borrow some tools from group theory. And there is the beautiful theorem of Kesten, which was his PhD thesis. And I only say in this form. So theorem of Kesten. And this tells you if you have an infinite graph, which is Ramanujan, and it's vertex transitive, then it's the tree. Okay, so that's a rigidity statement. If G is infinite Ramanujan, then G is G has no choice. It has to be the trick. Yes. Okay. This is definitely not true for non-transitive graphs. You can basically take a tree and put loops on it. Take a deregular tree except at the root and put loops of size 1 here. It tolerates roughly square root of the roots, and it still stays Ramanujan. The reason for that the random walk is it's like straying away. It will never see this guy. It won't see this guy too often. That's a vague argument, but it can be made precise. And that's a rigidity statement. But of course, you know, finite graphs are not vertex transitive. It also follows from this that a finite vertex transitive graph, Ramanujan graph, has large girth. So here is what you do. You use the machinery, and the observation you make, and this is about what's the extra force in the Benjamin-Schramm limit, is that the Benjamin-Schramm limit behaves like a vertex transitive graph in many senses. If you have a good enough property of vertex sensitive graphs, you can probably push it with a non-trivial proof, and you have to work, but you can push it over to random unimodular random graphs, the limits. Yeah, coming up. Let me tell what it says. Okay, so this random graph, the random graph that you get as a limit, as a Benjamin-Schramm limit, it cannot be just any random graph. The property that we are using, I only say it vaguely because it really takes 5 minutes to go through it, and I don't have 5 minutes. The property that you really do is that if you take this random graph and move the root to any given direction, you get a new random graph, right? This is the same old random graph. You get back the same distributions. It's an invariance property. Okay, and this is, of course, not meaningful because any direction doesn't make sense because direction doesn't make sense. In a graph, you cannot say just to the graph to go north, right, to the root. But it you know, you can define it. It works. And this property allows you, basically what happens is that once something happens in this system, like once you see a triangle, you have this rooted graph, assume that you see a triangle sitting on the root. Then you will see many triangles propping up in this random copy. It's kind of like a quasi-crystal, although you don't have this finiteness property. It's not true that it will happen with some fixed period. Okay, but it's true that it happens periodically with respect to random walk. The image that you should have in mind is that you have a measure space. This measure space is the rooted graph. Okay, you can read off the graph. This is a graphing, if you want. And you can read off the random graph by randomly picking the root and taking in the measure space and taking its connected component. Now, the set of points which sit on a triangle, it's a measurable subset of measure alpha. Okay, and assume that it's ergodic. The system is ergodic. It doesn't harm. And then what happens is that as you walk along this graph, you will sample the all the time you just fall into this trap. And then you will see a root in the connected component. Okay? So the point is that a unimodular random graph is homogeneous in this weak sense or quasi-periodic in this sense. And when you want to make it precise, you get back this definition. I mean, there is not much more to say about that. And this you can exploit. So it does, in many senses, it inherits properties of a vertex sensitive graph. So the simplest example, which is still nice, that I can tell you is this theorem that is not Stalling's theorem, but sadly I don't know, it's an ancient theorem. If you have a vertex sensitive graph, then it has either 1, 2, or infinitely many ends. Okay, who proved that first? That was, no. Stalling didn't prove, Stalling said when a group has infinitely many, he characterized when a group has infinitely many. This was Noam. Okay, sorry, I don't remember. Anyways, and this is not hard to prove. Do you know what ends are? I don't have to go into that, right? So the same holds for for a unimodular random graph. If you have a unimodular random graph, and it's ergodic, then it has either one, two, or infinitely many ends. Okay? The proof is harder. I mean, it takes one more twist. It's not very hard. I could tell it in, I don't know, 3 minutes. So here is the thing, though. This is exactly a beautiful statement about unimodular random graphs. You try to push it down to this universe of finite graphs, and you don't get much. Okay? So the state, you get some forced statement. That's the problem. Because n's just don't translate very well back into the finite universe. Okay? So this is what we proved. We basically proved the analog of this. This is with Glasner, Jai Glasner, and Balint Virag. And we just proved the analog of that for unimodular random graphs. So G is infinite Ramanujan unimodular random graph, then G is TD. Unimodular is that if you move the root, then it doesn't change the distribution. That's unimodularity. But if I have time at the end, I'll go into it. But it's a technical definition. It's not. Yeah. Okay. Anyways, any graph limit is unimodular. All right. So what does this imply? So actually, we found three different proofs for that. We really hated the first one. We liked the second one better, and we started to write up because we got stuck with the first one. And then after rewriting it three times, we hated it still. And then we found the right proof. So the proof that we have now, I'm really happy with. It's a group theoretical proof. It's about random walks on fundamental groups. And I'm not going to go into details. I don't have time for that. Anyways, this implies the following. It implies, so corollary, not just, it implies that Ramanujan graphs converge to the regular tree, first of all. But it implies more. It implies that graphs that are almost Ramanujan, if the spectral measure is supported, most of the spectral measure is supported on the Alambo-Panah band, then it still converges to the deregular tree. Okay? So I call it lambda, right? If lambda gn by minus rho td converges to 1, which means that, you know, most of the jelly is inside where you want it, then gn converges to td. As a corollary, lambda gn converges to lambda td. So this is a rigidity statement. You get a rigidity statement on eigenvalue distribution, and this is the rigidity statement. If you try to squeeze most of the jelly inside the Alambo-Panah bound, you will know its shape. Okay? Really?
Because it's not the spectral radius, it's plus epsilon.
But epsilon tends to zero.
For any you have a fixed epsilon, then.
For D, you have a fixed epsilon?
So what exactly is your statement about the spectral
radius? Okay. It's not about spectral radius, it's about spectral measure. Yeah, you want the following. You take a sequence of graphs. And you want that the spectral measure, or the eigenvalue distribution, of minus rho td, rho td.
Without slack in the whole. There is no slack in the whole.
Without what?
You don't add an epsilon.
No, you don't. You don't. Okay.
So. The theorem is about the outliers. He's never talking about these guys.
Yeah, I don't care how many bad bugs are out there. I mean, there can be a small order of n bad guys lurking out. I don't care, just that they measure this, they should diminish. Okay? So, all right, that's the theorem. So this says that, you know, if you push most of the measure inside, then it takes a well-defined shape. The jelly takes a well-defined shape. There is only one such guy. And actually, what is easy to see, and basically you see the proof, that this goes back as well. This is the easy part. So they are actually equivalent. So this kind of weakly Ramanujan graphs are exactly the graphs with essentially large girth. Or this is just looking at moments. So that's this is a triviality. And that's the new ingredient. Okay? So
essentially large girth will mean that from most points.
Yes. That's the same as converging to the tree in Benjamin Disham's sense, right? Yeah. And that's the same as spectral convergence. Okay. So in particular, Ramanujan graphs converge to the tree, which was also unknown before. That's also a new result. But there we have stronger results, so much stronger results. Okay, so this is, so Serv wrote a nice paper, and here is what he proved. He cared about these spectral measures, and he cared about their limit, and this is his theorem. So take Gn, take a sequence of graphs, such that the following holds. The limit of dk Gn over Gn, which we define by gamma n, exists. And dk is the it's not the number of returning paths of length k, it's the number of primitive returning primitive cycles of length k. Primitive means cyclic reduced and not a proper power of another cycle. Don't worry about that. And assume that you have a graph sequence where this converges, okay? Then, and assume that the growth of this guy is not too large. So if you take the sum of gamma k times d minus 1 to the k half, and it converges, that is, you know, if it doesn't grow very fast, sorry, if it doesn't decrease very slow, okay, then the following corollaries hold. First of all, lambda gn converges, and it converges to a measure, so the limit of lambda gn is supported on the Alan-Boppana interval. Okay. And also it's absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue measure. Okay, so let's understand what this says. You take any sequence of graphs where the normalized number of reduced cycles, you know, is convergent, and assume that it's that, you know, that the growth of that is not too big, then the spectral measures converge to something that lives inside the Alan-Boppana bound, and it's absolutely continuous. Okay, so now this theorem implies that this is that, you know, so corollary. In this case, gamma k is all zero for every k, and this measure, the limit of lambda gn, is simply lambda of td. Okay, so that looked like a very interesting class of graphs to study, but it's not. It's just one graph. It's an empty. No, it's not empty. There is one guy in here, and that's the deregular tree. So, all right. I don't want to say anything else. So actually, if you deal with honest Ramanujan graphs, not just graphs that are, you know, weakly or almost Ramanujan, then you get much more. And here we don't use unimodular random graphs or limit theory anymore. This is quantitative. You get that the essential girth is at least log-log. is at least log g, okay? So, and the essential graph, you know, you omit a small measure points. And, you know, random graphs have essential graph log g. And the LPS, the Lubotsky-Phillips Arnold graphs, also have essential graph, well, graph log g. So you would want to ask what's the truth, okay? And there is a disagreement. Balint thinks it's log g. I think it's log g. There is no strong arguments either way, so we don't know. Question. Log or log log? Definitely the methods we built only give log log.
What's the essential graph?
Essential graph that you know, you can leave a small subset from G, from Gn, measure tending to zero, ratio tending to zero, such that from the last of the points, the graph is at least log log.
So for random b-regular graphs, it's log, right?
It's log. Yeah, so random beats this so far. And you know, it's hard to test this theory because you don't know so many Ramanujan graphs. So it will be hard to prove that this is sharp. That would be, you know, building a completely new. It could be. There is nothing. We don't know. Yeah. You will not beat log log with our methods. That's fairly apparent. Okay. All right, I said what I wanted to say. So now let's go back to the. So any question about this part? I'm leaving it. All right, yes. Yes. That's true.
So
this is because it counts primitive cycles,
okay.
Basically. Okay, that's what's going on. Okay. All right, so let's get to the next part. I want to reach the astronomical part. There is an astronomy lecture coming.
It's not that the two fat sisters are astronomically fat.
No. It's about, I tell you while I'm doing this, you know, thing. So it's about finding a planet. I will not erase the fat sisters. So you want to find a planet, and just this month they found a new planet. Hooray. And they never seen the planet. What they did with the planet, they saw other planets around, and they calculated gravity. And the gravity changes suggested that there is a planet, and they could spot it. And this is something we will attempt now in statistical mechanics. I mean, that could be the framework. Huh?
Was this around our sun? Or
I don't think so. No, highly unlikely. It was. That would be. Then you would know about it, right? And you know, you could sell a lot of new toys, I guess. No, it must have been somewhere really far. Okay. So. Yeah, let me change the table and talk about that because this may be interesting for more people. And this is you know, let's find the planet now. Okay, so it starts with the paper of Jennifer and Christian and Jeff Kahn and Lati, which Jennifer gave a great talk about, and this is what they proved. Let me just repeat it. So TGK. That's log of the number of legal k colorings of G over G. Okay, that's the entropy, the coloring entropy of G with k colors. Okay, so what they proved works J scan Lovaas. That, you know, for big enough k, this is testable. So if k is greater than or equal than 2d, then this is testable. T GK is testable. Okay, so you can you understand what it means, right? So that's what it's a beautiful theorem. Somehow it tells you that if you lift above the threshold, then you randomly try to color, take a random legal coloring of your universe, then the correlation decays, becomes localized in a very strong sense. And that's behind it. That's one of the ways of saying it. And we were thinking about this with a student of Laci, Tamás Hubay. And this looks like, so these are the gravity things. For all k big enough, this is a gravity measurement of the graph. And we were wondering if there is a planet behind. I mean, if there is a planet hiding somewhere. So the first thing you suspect is the following. So that's an observation. Well, this is nothing else, t g of k, t g k. What is it? That's just the integral of log k minus z against d tau of g. I didn't tell you what tau of g is, right? So that's not so impressive so far. And what is d tau of g? This is the roots of the root distribution of the chromatic polynomial. Okay, so tau g root distribution of the chromatic polynomial. And people care about roots of the chromatic polynomial. It's a very mysterious subject. My understanding is that some statistical physicians also care about roots of chromatic polynomial, because that's the win I have to tell the sentence that I don't really understand yet. This is the anti-ferromagnetic Potts model on zero temperature. Did I say it right? Yeah. So if you want to understand the behavior of that, then so I am understanding it on the level that I could bullshit about it, but I really don't understand this word. That's the reason, I want to learn it, definitely. And so this is something that, that captures phase transitions. So that's why you look at the root. And Ellen Sokal wrote a substantial amount of papers on roots of the chromatic polynomial because of that, coming from statistical mechanics. So you want to look at that. What does this suggest immediately to you? What is the planet? This is a fixed function, right? And you have a sequence of measures. And you know that it converges in Benjamin-Isham convergence. So what it suggests to you, well, it suggested to us, that maybe simply this chromatic distribution, the chromatic measure, weakly converges for Benjamin-Isham convergent sequence of graphs. Okay? So the basic theorem that you have to know here, there you go, the following. It's a theorem of Sokal. It tells you that this measure is supported on a bounded disk. Okay. So tau g is supported on B0 C times D, C is an absolute constant, less than 8. Okay? So the whole measure lives inside this disk. All right? And then you want to know whether it weakly converges. It's a sequence of compactly supported measures. Well, okay, so this is not true. Turns out this is too much to hope for. This would be the planet that you find, right? You have this Benjamin-Isham convergent sequence of graph. You take the measurements on large integers. It gives you some gravity data, and based on that gravity data, you would hope to find that there is a sequence of measures living here will converge. Okay? Well, it's not true. Simply, it's not true, because if you take the path of length n, or the cycle of length n, the chromatic root for the path of length n, that will be just supported on the point one, with a very small measure. Well, will be n minus 1 over n roots here and 1 root here, right? So in limit, this gives you just the Dirac measure on 1. If you look at Cn, then you see the you see see this picture, okay? And in limit, this will be the unit circle around one. Okay, so it can blow up. Although, of course, Pn and Cn converge to the same object in Benjamin-Isham sense. So, okay, so, you know, that's the difference between, actually, that's the difference between a kid and a mathematician. So how do you get this from this? Okay, you draw a circle around it. That's what a kid would say. What does a mathematician say? I tell you. You take this measure, you pick a random point, you start a Brownian motion, and you wait until it hits the boundary of this, and then you stop. So you smash out the measure with the Brownian motion to the circle. Okay, that's how you do it. And this is closer to what you want to look at than drawing a circle. So this doesn't work anyways. There is no planet. I mean, it's like a, if I didn't hate quantum, I would say it's a quantum planet. So, you know, it can take many shapes, although the Benjamin-Isham thing, information is the same. But at least the holomorphic moments are testable. Okay? So that's my theorem over there. That tells you that the integral of z to the k d tau g is testable. Okay, so in particular, for any holomorphic function that lives on this disk, the integral against that function is testable, will be Benjamin-Isham continuous. Okay, so this means that you will not see the planet. Sadly, that's not a nice vision. It can just blur, the roots can just jump around, but their usual moments stay under control. And one way to look at this is that you just take the SoCal disk, and you know send the measure out, trash the measure out to the boundary of the disk using a Brownian motion, and this sequence of measures will be weakly convergent. So that's just a vision of something you want to look at, okay? Because there is only, you know, for any given sequence of moments, there is only one measure on the boundary. So that's what you can see. You never see the planet. You see some, like, you know, blown up planet. All right. So this is what we proved. And then later, two smart young Hungarians, Csikvári and Frenkel. So Csikvári is, Peter is here. You can talk to him if you want. They generalized it to the Todd polynomial. Okay, so it's the same phenomenon. If you fix one of the variables, then in the other variable, you know, once you stay outside the bounded disk, you're fine. You will be supported on a bounded disk, and you get, you know, convergence in real moments. And, you know, this is not just a generalization. Our proof was the, you know, go and kill it kind of proof, you know, no questions asked about the method. But they found the book proof. So they found a beautiful proof. That's kind of the real proof for this year. So. Yes, exactly. It's testable, and there is a SoCal type theorem. There will be a disk where the roots live. So in particular, if you're outside that disk, then if you integrate this thing, you know, log z0 minus z, again, that will be convergent. So actually what you get that the log of the chromatic polynomial converges uniformly outside a bounded disk. The same for the Todd polynomial. So one thing that this gives you, well, one thing that it doesn't give you, it should give you, but it doesn't, is Russ's theorem, Russ Lyons's theorem. And this is that the tree entropy is testable. So log of the number of spanning trees G divided by G is testable. Okay, so the sad news is that this is really this guy, the number of spanning trees, that's really just one entry at the Todd polynomial. I think it's the Todd polynomial and at 1, 2, not sure. But that's inside the bed, that's inside the corresponding SoCal disk. So you cannot apply the convergence theorem, okay? A priori, it could happen that inside the SoCal disk, you try to evaluate it, and one root, just one root jumps very close to your testing point, and that will, you know, that will kill the convergence, okay? So nevertheless, this is a theorem. And now you want to ask whether, you know, other nice places of the Todd polynomial is true, so just a test question. This is an open problem. So if you look at the number of connected subgraphs, you know, the entropy of that, is it testable or not? Yeah, you won't get much help. Okay, so the reason, somehow the reason in my head, the reason why this is true, the testability of spanning trees, because you can express it in terms of the spectral measure again. And the spectral measures converge in a strong enough sense that you can derive it from that. This is just the integral of some log function against the spectral measure. Again, and you can see that it's like it thins out there. So it won't cause a lot of trouble. That's not formally how Russ proved it. You can talk about it in that language. So, okay. So the last thing I want to talk about is mod p L2 Betti numbers. Where is it? So I told you that the rank of the normalized rank of the adjacency matrix is testable. And this is actually, this gives you a nice theorem, it's so-called Luke approximation theorem, in the following form. So how many of you guys know what are L2 Betti numbers? Just a quick test. I will do like this, so I already see the kind of, okay. So probably I'm not going to defining them. They are important invariants of manifolds, simplicial complexes, okay? And you sort of when Attia defined them first for Riemannian manifolds, and somehow it's a very infinite thing. But it turns out to be much better behaving than just normal Betti numbers for many purposes. Okay. How much time do I have left? Like zero?
6 minutes.
6 minutes? Okay, so I have to make a compromise. The compromise I will make that I just ask you to believe that L2 Betti numbers are cool, they're important, they're beautiful, and I just go into the graph theory. I think that's better for everyone. So what does this really say? So this says, well, I cheated a bit. Where did I cheat? I cheated because I told you that the rank of the adjacency matrix is testable. What I didn't tell you is over what field, right? I didn't tell you. So over what field? And actually, the theorem as it works only over Q, or you know, anything in zero characteristic. So the Q rank of the adjacency matrix of G over G is testable. What about FP? And this is very much unknown. And we tried it many ways. It didn't work so far. If this would work, if it would turn out that the FP rank is also testable, which doesn't look like a much harder problem from a graph theory point of view than the Q rank, maybe even easier, right? Then this would give rise to a theory of mod p L2 Betti numbers. And that would be not only cool, it would be useful for many purposes, because sometimes you want to know that data, the behavior of the mod p homology, better than the behavior of just the normal, the Q homology, the asymptotic behavior. So that's an open question. And basically, the ideas that we tried are the following. So basically, it's kind of let's try to forget that this is a linear notion. Okay, that's the idea. It's of course a linear notion. It's like a linear, the dimension of a linear subspace, right? Let's try to forget about it. Let's pass. You can, if you try to for,